Hello everyone, you're watching Mario's History Talks. I'm Mario Rostovsky, and we have a great show for you this evening. So, Bulgaria has had quite an eventful last couple of weeks, which can best be described by an old Three Stooges bit, where Mo steps into a rake, gets hit in the face, falls back, steps into a shovel. I mean, not only did the extremist Vomero Bulgarian Party come out with a paltry 3.62% of the total vote in the elections, you know, the same party that promised to make Macedonia Bulgarian again. But the US State Department also released a condemning report on Bulgaria's egregious human rights abuses towards its Macedonian minority, the same minority that Karakachanov and Jabaski both claimed doesn't exist, right before they were voted away into oblivion. Now, of course, a Macedonian minority does exist in Bulgaria. This has been documented by not only the State Department, EU Human Rights Watch, I mean, court rulings, old census reports, and even the Macedonians themselves there. Here is a photo of the Pedin Macedonians during a recent celebration commemorating the 143rd anniversary of the Kresna Uprising, along with a portrait of its immortal leader, an often unsung hero in the Macedonian pantheon, one Dimitar Popgeorgiev Berovski, a man I'm guessing you've not heard too much about. So why is this man so crucial to the identity of the Macedonians in Pedin? Well, I'm glad you asked. So without any further ado, let's go over what you need to know about Berovski. So Berovski was born in Berovo, his namesake, in the Malešovo region of Macedonia in 1840. He completed his primary education in Berovo and then studied at the Odessa Theological Seminary in Ukraine from 1858 to 1860. However, his revolutionary fervor often clashed with the seminary and discipline of the theological school, so like many Macedonians of the day, he went on to enroll in a military academy in Belgrade, where he participated in both the Serbian army as well as the 1st Bulgarian Legion in Belgrade. And in 1865, Berovski does return to Berovo, and he is elected the headmaster of the local schools there, as well as the head of the church school community. And like many Macedonians before and after him, he uses this position to push for societal reform within Macedonia, which for Berovski was directed primarily against the Hellenizing pressure of the Greek Patriarchate Church, as well as the subsequent renewal of the Ohrid Archbishopric Church. In fact, it was neither through Greek or Serbian channels that Berovski hoped to accomplish this, but through the Vatican. Berovski was in fact a pragmatic supporter of the Uniate movement to restore the Ohrid Church, which was essentially a movement that still fought for an Orthodox Church, but one that would be in full communion with the Roman Catholic Church. And as part of this movement, spearheaded by Berovski, we see in the 1870s a slow chipping away of the Bulgarian Church's influence in Ceres, Milnik, Strumica, Vodin, Kukush, Solun even. All of these churches essentially went to the Uniate Church as a stepping stone to the eventual renewal of the Ohrid Church. But we can talk about more on this in a future episode. What I want you to know is Berovski was in fact successful in expelling the Greek bishop Kombinos from Berovo. However, this came at a cost, and Berovski was forced into exile in Constantinople. Later, however, he did manage to sneak back into Macedonia legally. He came to Solun, and in Solun, together with the Macedonian patriotic intelligentsia, he formed an underground association, informally called the Macedonian Don, whose goal and aims would move past just simple reforms for the Macedonian peasant, but towards full-scale liberation from the Ottoman yoke. And this is where we see Berovski's dedication and character truly show. Underfunded, undersupplied, and desperate, as the Macedonian movement has always been, Berovski turned to his own pocket to procure funds, raise supplies, and raise weaponry for the actual uprising. He went on to sell off his real estate holdings, his businesses, his assets on Berovo just to raise money. Crazy to think he didn't just think to go on a Facebook post and rant about it like the rest of us. He actually put his money where his mouth was. Now, with all this in mind, preparations came and went for the first major uprising that was headed by Berovski under the famous Makedonija Stanite Deve Osvobodi banner of 1875, an uprising called the Razvolici Uprising. Now, this uprising unfortunately was suppressed by the Ottomans and ended in failure, but this is not where the story of Berovski ends. He and his force of men, they regroup, retreat, and strategically wait to fight another day. And that day would come 3 years later on October 13th, 1878, forever eternalized in the collective Macedonian memory by the simplest yet most profound name there can be, the Macedonian Uprising. Now, I'm going to dedicate a whole video to talk about the Macedonian Uprising, its implications, and exactly what happened, but here's what you need to know from a surface level view. The Macedonian Uprising was launched by an attack on a Turkish garrison in Kresna in Pirin, Macedonia. And this time, the major organizers were Berovski, Stoyan Karastoyev, Dedo Ilio Malishevsky, and the Metropolitan Nathaniel of Ohrid. Berovski was the chief staff of the Macedonian Uprising, and Karastoyev was his right-hand man, the chief duke of the insurgents. Now, this grassroots Macedonian uprising was initially a strong success. I mean, it spread all over to cover Melnik, Delchevo, Berovo, and even Dimitrisar. In fact, it got to the point where the leaders had to actually think about setting up a local civil administration to deal with taxes, conscripting an army, public works, and public service. In fact, we have the preamble and the whole constitution to what will be called the Rules of the Macedonian Committee. Here's a direct quote. It is well known to all of us that this ill-fated country of ours, Macedonia, owing to the egotistical aims of the great powers, was again left to Turkey after the Congress of Berlin. As a result of that, in certain regions of our fatherland, many scenes full of blood known to all of us took place. Desiring to throw off the Turkish yoke from our fatherland, each of us, as much as possible, rose up to sacrifice himself since help was needed from each of us. We rebelled as advocates of freedom. With the blood we shed all over the Macedonian fields and forests, we serve freedom as the Macedonian army of Alexander of Macedon did, with our slogan, freedom or death. Yet, owing to the events of the liberation of a great number of our villages by our rebels, and the crying need to introduce order into the areas where the rebellion has taken action, we have decided to proclaim certain rules of the Macedonian Rebel Committee, or rather, a constitution to which we shall all conform and the rules of which we shall all observe until the liberation of the whole of our fatherland, Macedonia, is complete. Pretty powerful stuff. Now, as I said, the first stage of this native uprising proved to be a success. I mean, it was a success until it was no longer native. In fact, this Macedonian uprising was one of the first major clashes between the Macedonian and the Bulgarian revolutionary visions for the territory, which led to its downfall. Well, what exactly happened? I'm going to talk about this in a future episode, like I said, but in a nutshell, it was the more pro-Bulgarian oriented Nathaniel of Ohrid, the Metropolitan, that because of him, Bulgarian influence vis-a-vis the Unity Committee seeped its way into the organization. And this Unity Committee was a Bulgarian bourgeois group formed in Bulgaria as a result of the reversal of the San Stefano Treaty to further pan-Bulgarian unity across what they saw as Bulgarian lands. And as such, because of the influence of Nathaniel, two Bulgarians of Russian origin, Louis Wodekiewicz and Adam Kalmykov, they were added to the committee as the external representatives of the Unity Committee for the Kresna Uprising. Remember, this was still a period of heavy Russian influence in the Bulgarian nation-making, the creation of the Bulgarian state, constitution, as well as the whole revolutionary movement. Everything from what constituted the Bulgarian lands to what the general grand strategy was to be for this movement still centered around generally favorable Russian geopolitical interests. And this clash essentially started when these two Russian Bulgarians within the committee essentially started to wrestle control from the local native administration and align it more with the Unity Committee, which wanted to create more rebellions and spread the revolution across Macedonia as fast as possible to draw European attention. Whereas the local Macedonian leaders wanted to increase their supplies, increase their manpower, and secure their positions before anything further was to happen. Now, Berovski, he was furious at this, and we know from a letter dated the 22nd of October, 1878, in harsh words sent to the Jumaya Committee, he stated the following about them. He said, "How do such people, like Detyevich and Kalmykov, and get involved in such hallowed work? To sully it? To ruin it? We will discuss this incident and the committee plans. We were not aware of how much the committee was among us. Now, this clash grew so severe that the Unity Committee not only set forth to entirely replace the leadership of the Macedonian Uprising with their own leaders, but they actually ordered the execution of both Berovski and Karastoljov, as well as everybody close to them. Now, fortunately, Berovski did manage to escape his planned assassination, but unfortunately, on the 25th of November, 1878, Karastoljov, as well as his chetniks Georgi Chaprashinkov and Jovan Trendafilov, they were assassinated. Hey, so much for pro-Bulgarian unity. This was actually done by the Unity Committee themselves. So, what happens at this stage? Well, the Unity Committee did succeed in establishing complete control over the Macedonian Uprising. However, their presence there, as well as their strategic blunders, as well as their overall goals, did demoralize the actual fighters in the movement. And the entire uprising would soon crash and burn like the Hindenburg disaster in the months to follow. What started off as a promising and actually well thought out uprising did end in failure. Now, of course, you must be sitting there much like Marty McFly was in the Back to the Future series, being told of this clash between a local Macedonian native organization and that with a cut-off and more paternalistic outside Bulgarian committee trying to wrestle control from it. And you're probably sitting there thinking much like Marty,
hey, I've seen this one.
Because you have. And it was something in the future that would go on to happen between the Macedonian Revolutionary Organization as well as the Supremacists in the decades to follow. As I said, folks, Mark Twain put it best. History doesn't repeat itself, but it certainly can rhyme from time to time, which is exactly what's happening here. But despite its failure, folks, at the end of the day, this uprising, the first stages of it, was exactly what Berovski described in his letters, used on his stamps, as well as his signatures, the Macedonian Uprising. No prefixes, no suffixes, no qualifiers, as pure of a Macedonian movement as it could be. Now, Berovski, after this movement, I mean, he did go on to have a famed military career, but he was unfortunately never able to regain the strength and the momentum that was lost after the Macedonian Uprising. He would go on to reside in Houston till afterwards and led a career both in public service as both a military officer in the Serbo-Bulgarian War, as well as the chief of police, whose position afforded him the ability to essentially turn the other way and look towards supplying the actual Macedonian rebels in Macedonia with weapons and money, this time headed by the new generation of revolutionary leaders like Kotsedelchev and Georgi Petrov. Now, at this time, he even sets up numerous Macedonian philanthropic and charity organizations within Bulgaria to still support the cause and fund it from abroad. He never lay low. So with all this in mind, what can we glean from Berovski's life? I mean, this was a man whose zeal and dedication for Macedonia knew no price. He had a practical political and military philosophy and a massive organizing rebellion. This was not a man drawn and swayed by idealistic plans made by some bureaucrat in a distant office. This was somebody who had practical, bare bones essentials to his planning. And more importantly, he had skin in the game. He put his own money into the efforts and he fought his own battles alongside his men. And that is truly what leadership is. And that, my friends, is why our Macedonian brothers and sisters in Pitting Macedonia continue to honor this man and his legacy year after year. But even then, we still must caution ourselves and remember that even the best among us, like Berovski, did still trust the untrustworthy within their own circles because of the promises of strong alliances and material support from abroad. And this is a drug that all desperate Macedonians have succumbed to at least once in their lives, but has never, ever worked out well for us. So, I want you to kind of think about that. Think of how much Berovski and his life and his experiences in the Macedonian Uprising would go on to mirror exactly what happened down the line with Kotsedelchev, with MRO, with the supremacists, how it's still happening today within Macedonia. It all starts and ends with Macedonians being swayed by a promise that never pans to reality. So folks, I really hope you did enjoy this episode of Berovski. Like I said, to me, he's definitely more unsung hero in the Macedonian pantheon. To me, he's amazing. He is truly awe-inspiring. We can still learn from his successes and failures, though, but he definitely deserves our praise for all his continued efforts throughout our history to free Macedonia. So in the meantime, folks, I'll get to work on another episode with more events, leaders, and information I think you should know about in this battle that we're engaged in to defend our identity. So in the meantime, folks, I really hope you stay safe, keep fighting for Macedonia, and I'm going to see you again soon. So golem patriotski pozdrav.